one final question, and it's a matter of methodological question, and it perhaps it has to do with knowledge points. Let's say the anthropologist who goes and does his or her field work and translates the quote unquote the experience that people are having into a kind of an anthropological language. There is a movement now among some new anthropologists to go back and say to the people, this is what I've written about you. Do you think that I haven't gotten it right? And oftentimes they say, no, no, we haven't gotten it wrong. Because it's very difficult for an observer to actually get into the culture.
Yes, it must be wonderful to have that experience of going back and having them say no, it's wrong, because then they would learn quite a lot. I've only had the other experience, which is only too common, I'm afraid, with the anthropologists in Africa, to go back and show, and they've read the book, and they said, wonderful, and it's exactly how we were, and how great that you got us down on paper, kind of experience. That wasn't what you were asking.
No, but it's interesting that they can say that, but oftentimes something gets lost in the translation.
Of course an awful lot gets lost. It depends on how you, I mean, I don't say the word right, you know. I'm sure it's not that. I had a very superficial knowledge of the tribe for all sorts of reasons. I think it's a very generous kind of people, the Africans, but this is what they do right to. So if you go to Canada, if you go, I heard, if you go to Brittany or Europe, you get this bad experience because you get caught up in the factions. But I think you're raising a very fundamental issue of contemporary anthropology about whether it's even appropriate or legitimate to pretend to know anything about anybody else. But I really disagree deeply with that, because it's the end of all inquiry. It's a return of the whole project of knowledge back into the individual inquirer. In the end, you end up with him looking at himself and saying, look at me, how marvelously complex and frustrated I am.
It becomes sort of solipsistic.
Absolutely solipsistic, yes.
And whereas an older anthropology would be really based on a structure.
Well, it's based on a theory. If you haven't got a theory, you've got no right to go out. But you have to have some theoretical training, and then and that can be bad or good. And people should argue about that. But not about the possibility of knowledge. They are being nihilistic about knowledge, in my opinion. And will end up with nothing, as predicted by the name, nihilist. Whereas things are very important, especially now with development problems. We really have to go forth and be responsible. And I think it's very irresponsible not to try to have theoretical ideas about the relation of society to its environment, to other peoples, to each other. There's one more thing I'd like to say, because I keep having this interview, and I keep, perhaps out of politeness, I don't know, or reticence, not going on with the point that's important. You can't really have a theory without a typology. And some sensitive souls really would prefer not to typologize, which, in my opinion, means preferring not to think. But consequently, our system, which is to start out thinking of how many kinds of culture do we need to have in order to theorize about the relation of individuals who claim to the public, the idea of the public community. We have four kinds, and it's by exploring the implications of this thought theoretically that I think we make great advances in understanding. And one kind is hierarchical, one kind is individualistic. And if you stay within our individualistic society, you can go on moaning and protesting against what are, in effect, the ills of individualism. Instead of trying to cure the system, you entrench it even deeper. And the other kind is sectarian or enclave protest. The other kind is just being cut off and isolated. So that this theoretical approach has to start with four kinds. And this is where we've gone to with my very fruitful and innovative, really quite brilliant colleague who worked with me, whom I should mention perhaps, right? Michael Thompson, who writes about risk, mountaineering, Nepalese, about poverty, architecture, all it was in this book. And Stephen Rayner, who does works on risk analysis through this approach, different kinds of cultural attitudes to risk. Yes, it's a big theme. Yes. But it's very central to this whole approach. You mentioned before we came in about taboos. Taboos in this analysis are publicly standardized agreements about what it is dangerous to do on the political, moral, and social level that will unleash attacks on the environment or break down the environment so that people's illnesses and sicknesses are explained by their moral failures. And each culture could be counted as a list, could be associated with a catalogue of things that one shouldn't do, and of the vulnerable parts of the human body or the environment of the human body, which would be threatened. So dangers are part of the other side of the analysis of the goods that a culture is saying. And the list of dangers gives you a better approach to the kind of culture it is. If they're dangerous to the individual or dangerous to the whole community, then you know if they're more afraid of the individual being attacked by the community, then you know it's an individualist protecting kind of culture, which is what ours is. So if we really want to muster, to mobilize support for the environment, we have to point out always that there's individual health risk, that it's not a thing in itself that the whole community needs, because it can't muster. So the whole thing is organized, all the institutions are thinking about individuals. Yeah. Got it. And if you're a hierarchical system, it's the whole that people are worrying, have been set up the institutions to worry about. So they're hearing messages about the whole and not so much messages about the individuals. Not that they're going to necessarily protect the environment better. They're going to probably be more predatory upon the environment in the name of the whole. That doesn't guarantee. But all the same, it's a different kind of analysis, and it turns up much more self-knowledge by seeing ourselves reflected in other cultures, as a contrast to other cultures, and always reflected within our own culture.
You were starting talking about colleagues.
Oh yes, Mike Thompson, Steve Rayner, on risk, and on small Maoist sectarian groups in British politics. Jerry Mars on occupational crime in modern industrial society, using this kind of analysis for that. A great book on troops at work in my bibliography. Aaron Wadowski on political regimes, California. Political analysis in these terms. Well, there's so many. Those are some of the core ones.